us as your children, joint heirs with Christ, as we talked about in our men's Bible study yesterday. We are joint heirs with Christ. We thank you for that. Lord, we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stepped on my skirt. You know, there's been a lot on the news this last week about a launch into the heavens, an unmanned launch of a capsule that landed on the space station. It's all been plotted. It's all been mathematically calculated so that it would be perfectly set. But you know, we serve a God who can do things that are indescribable. And you can look into the heavens and see his perfections that are beyond words, and you will find them every day. It doesn't take a mathematician to find these things or to see these things. You can look into the heavens and you can plot these things every day. You know exactly what star is where, from what season of the year. And you'll be able to see and know what our indescribable God has put in the heavens. Our offertory hymn this morning is just that. It's indescribable. Let's stand, please, and sing.
Revealing your majesty.
give you a real quick physics lesson as well as an astronomy lesson this morning. That's exactly what Carol's talking about. When I was younger and running sports fishing boats and head boats and stuff, I learned the value of a compass rose and running a course to the Bahamas. And the reason we have a compass and we can trust a compass to get us to the Bahamas is because of magnetic north. You know magnetic north is not true north, right? At 19, I went on a sailboat. We sailed it up down the ocean to New York. We were out of sight of land for the first 5 days and the last 2 days. And we had a navigator that navigated with a sextant, which is navigation from true north. And I don't remember any of it, and I couldn't do it today if I tried, but he taught me at the time how to read the sextant and how to do the deviation calculations between due north and what was on the compass rose on the boat. And he was always verifying our compass wherever we were by true north. And true north is where the North Star's at. So you learn the reason that man can do that is because we already have a God that has put things in place that we can depend on. Okay? Both the compass rose based on magnetic north, and as long as your compass is correct and calibrated correctly, no matter where you go on this planet, you'll know where north is. Magnetic north. If you want to know where true north is, you use a sextant and you deviate it based on how far north towards the North Pole you get or the South Pole you get, and the sextant will tell you where you are based on true north. So that's just your lesson for this morning. Let's have a word of prayer and we'll take up our offering. Father, we thank you that you're a God of creation and you put it all in place and you've organized it all and you control it all and we can trust you for it all. And Father, that we can depend on it ourselves and use it. We're told to have dominion and to utilize the earth for our benefit, and we do that. And now we can actually send people into space and bring them around the moon and bring them back, and all the stuff we've done is mankind using the principles that you put in place and the mathematics that you have created into our systems. And we can put them in computers and we can calculate all this stuff. We know exactly when the next solar eclipse is going to happen and where it's going to happen. And we can calculate all this stuff because you created it all in your majesty. And we thank you for that today, Lord. I pray as we take up this offering, it'll excite us about the God we serve. And Father, I pray that you'll continue to bless us so we can continue to support this ministry and reach out to this community and see lives changed and people give their life to Christ and be baptized and serve you in this community. So ultimately, you get the glory and you build your kingdom through the ministry of this church. And we thank you for the opportunity today. In Jesus' name, amen.
You, he loves me, he loves every child he sees, Jesus. This is when we pray. He'll take care of us every day. He loves you, he loves me, he loves every child who sees Jesus.
Oh, here's some more coming to go. Aren't they beautiful? Look. Oh, we've got to stop. Patty's got some more. How precious. They're so sweet. Okay, we're going to go. Let's stand as we, I could stand and watch them. They're beautiful. We're going to prepare our hearts and our minds for the message of the morning as we sing a couple songs, because we're going to look into the holiness of the Lord, and then we're going to get our heart ready for the worship of the morning. So let's sing.
When I look into your home,
I worship you.
is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. All about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. All about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. All about you, Jesus. It's all about you.
We've been talking on Sunday mornings about sharpening our vision as a church. And as you know, I've shared my passion about young people. And I've been involved in youth ministry for a long time. And I love young people. And they're really my passion. I was kind of hoping when God called me to full-time work that maybe it was going to be a youth pastor. But that didn't where I ended up. But I've learned that life is a big puzzle with lots of pieces. And as believers in Christ, we're building God's kingdom. He's building it through us. And everybody sitting in this room today, if you know Jesus Christ, your personal Lord and Savior, and have surrendered your life to Him, you're a piece of His puzzle. And not only that, but you're responsible for where those pieces go and what you do with them. Okay? From Isaiah 55, we read Verse 6, seeking him early. And as men and women were to flee from evil and were to pursue him first and foremost in our lives. And he tells us that he doesn't think like we think, and he doesn't do what we want him to do the way he wants us to do it. And I don't know about you, but that was a shock to me when I first got saved. I was such a nice guy, I figured he'd want to do it just like me, right? Not quite how it works. I learned over the years I'm not in control of anything. So, but then he says in verse 11, and again we spent some time on this yesterday in the men's Bible study, "So shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth, it shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I sent it." You know the value of the Bible in your life and mine. The Word, having the Word of God in our presence that we can study today. We've got so much commentary and dictionaries and books on top of books and computer programs and apps on your cell phone. And I mean, we are totally without excuse. All of us. We're not knowing the Word of God. We've been talking about the mission field, and it's all around us. Most of us in the room would be considered probably baby boomers. And we've got a little mix of all of this today. And again, my passions probably starts at X and Z and Y. Is, you know, I call myself a dinosaur because I'm learning that the breakdown of Titus chapter 2 is reality in our society today. And Titus chapter 2 talks about the older men teaching the younger men and the older women teaching the younger women. And that's broken down today, big time. And what do you learn when you get involved in the younger people, particularly Ys and Zs, that they go to their peers or they go to Google or they go to their cell phones for their wisdom. And they no longer go to their parents. They no longer go to their pastor. They don't go to their youth pastor. They don't even go to older men or women. They just flat go to their peers. And when we have an immature teenager going to other immature teenagers for counsel, guess what they're going to get? Immaturity. Okay? And that's where our mission field is today. Those of us that are older trying to reach down into the younger group and reach out to them, that's what we're facing. They're no longer honoring mom and dad. They're no longer respecting our opinions. They're no longer want to hear pretty much of anything we want to say. And it isn't just me. I know having talked to a bunch of you here going through the same thing with your kids and grandkids. It's across the board in Western culture today. Okay, so it's not anything new. What's the world like today? Confusion? Change, violence, divisiveness. That's the puzzle today. It's so scrambled, nobody knows where to even start putting it back together. That's society today. We have the message. I pointed that out last couple of weeks. This is the answer. Jesus is the answer. Amen? Jesus is the answer. The only answer for all that other stuff. And he's going to do it his way, as we already read in Isaiah. It's not going to happen like we expect it. He's not going to swoop in tomorrow with kumbaya and lovey-dovey and all of us get along all of a sudden. That's not what the Bible teaches. So if that's your idea, you're in the wrong place. Okay? That's not what's going to happen. Not what the Bible teaches. The message is clear. we're to present it faithfully. The gospel should be proclaimed in the love of Christ and the truth of the Word of God, or keep your mouth shut. Okay? Seriously. The Bible, the message is simple. Jesus Christ God became a man in the name of Jesus Christ, and He lived among us for 3.5 years, and He died on a cross, and He shed His blood for the forgiveness of our sins, and He's resurrected the third day and raised from the dead, and today is seated at the right hand of the Father as our advocate and coming back. And that's just, and you just got to trust that. Everything else is academic and immaterial. All the other stuff we like to discuss. The issue is, if you die today, where are you going? And why? And then, as we talked about in Sunday school, what's your life about? Ask Solomon. We're in Ecclesiastes 2 today, right? Richest man's ever lived, had it all. The summary is, this life is vexation of spirit. It's a waste of time. Isaiah 40 verse 8 says, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of God stands forever. Matthew, New Testament, 24:35 says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. This book is eternal. We're going to have it in glory forever. We're going to have the Word of God. The generations are lost at every level. There's lost souls. Pick any age group you want. Okay. Now what you learn, and I've said this recently, most of the people that get saved by the age of about 12 or 13. The minute they hit 16, the statistics drop off the planet. And the older you get, the less people get saved. That's just the statistics. What's going on back here this morning? It's the most important thing going on in this church every week. It's back here. Because that's where most of the kids will get saved. Before they get out of this group. Okay? That's true. That's just fact. Statistical correctness. Okay? It's our job to reach them. We're all told to go into the world and preach the gospel, right? Not just my job. Not just the deacon's job, the elder's jobs, or the Sunday school teacher's jobs. It's your job. We all have sphere of influence. We all have part of the puzzle. I can't witness to the people you witness to, and I certainly can't share your testimony and accomplish anything. I can only go to the people I have contact with, and I could share my testimony and hope the Holy Spirit does something with it. I did that with two young men this week, and I'm praying God will reach them both for Christ. And they'll sell their souls for Jesus Christ. Young men got their whole lives ahead of them, and they're screwing it up right now. And I'm trying to give them some guidance and some counsel. Shared my whole testimony with them. In their face. Yeah, I can do that with teenagers. I'm not shocked. I lived like hell till I was 22. I understand what it's like. Okay? You can't share my testimony. I'm asking myself about culture. And I went back 20 years just thinking through what our young people today, under, say, 35, what they have experienced in the last 20 years. Because I'm discounting the first 15 years of their life, they were kids. Knew nothing, pretty much. Except how to hopefully obey mom and dad, right? But 20 years. Columbine, 1999. Shocked the world. Kids killing kids in high school. Shock the world. Those of us old enough remember, right? Divided nation politically. 2000, a year later. Totally divided. I mean, look at the numbers. So politically, we've got parties that are fighting over who's right, who's wrong, politically where the world should go, where America should go, and how we should conduct ourselves. And we're divided right down the middle. Oops, I missed one. Where'd my slide go? Okay, I got to back up. I missed a slide. I don't know. I dropped the slide. I had a slide of 9-1-1, 2001. I had a slide there. Changed America forever. If you're like me, you can remember exactly where you first heard about it. And if you went home with a sick stomach like I did about an hour and a half later and watched the rest of the afternoon, it was a horrible, horrible day to watch what happened. As almost 3,500 of our fellow Americans lost their lives between the Twin Towers, the Pentagon, and the plane that went down in Pennsylvania. It was horrible. Terrorism had come to this country really for the first time. And it had been here before, but this time it killed a lot of people. And it was horrible to watch it. And two iconic towers in Washington went to the ground. And within a year, we were in Afghanistan from 2001 to 2014. And our young people growing up have heard over and over again, watching Humvees blown up and all the kind of stuff going on in the Afghan war. Then we turned around in 2003. We went to Iraq, and we were in Iraq for 8 years in Iraq, watching Humvees blown up and toppling Saddam Hussein and all the stuff that's gone on. And our young people have watched all of that and watched the money that went into that. Okay? To try to protect our freedoms. 4 years later, 2005, we're still split politically, right down the middle. Okay? Even the incumbent president almost didn't get reelected. 2008, financial collapse. Worried about it, the next depression. Being in real estate, wasn't a good time to be in real estate. Millions of Americans lost their homes in foreclosure over the next 5, 6, 8 years. Empty houses everywhere. Foreclosures. Some of us in that business know what that was like. 2008. Still divided. Still divided. Nothing's changed. 2012, Sandy Hook, elementary school. 26 lost their lives. Okay? Kids killing kids again. 2012, still divided politically. 2013, lost a marathon. Can't even have a marathon without violence. Right in the middle of the street. Two years ago, Las Vegas, what, 59 killed? This is what our young people are growing up with. This is their life that they're seeing around them every day. Right here in our backyard. A year ago. Okay? High school again. Columbine all over again. This is what our young people are being raised with. This is what they've seen in the last 20 years regarding our culture and our life and their life that they're living in, the world they're living in. This is what they're seeing. Front page headlines every few days. Right? Now, I don't want to be a deadbeat here, but folks, this is reality. This is the puzzle that they're seeing. That's why it's in shambles. Where's the hope in this? World of confusion, change, violence, and divisiveness. That's where America is today. Most of the world is in this, not just America. It's worldwide. Okay? Looks like Little Rocket Man may start shooting rockets off again. I don't know. But the world's in a mess. This is what our kids are seeing. You wonder why I'm passionate about kids. The epidemic right now in teen suicide has gone off the roof. Gone out of the roof. Listen to a pastor recently talking about preaching to 45,000, and they did a deal. He was burdened about, had a vision of a young girl that was wanting to commit suicide, and he gave a testimony in front of a bunch of kids about anybody here that has already written a letter to their parents and have a plan to commit suicide, raise your hand. And over 400 kids raised their hand in an auditorium of 4,500. That's almost 10% of the young people in that arena are considering suicide. And you wonder why I'm passionate about kids. This is real stuff, folks. I ask myself, why? I'm going to give you some reasons, three real quick ones. I was shocked when I started researching this. You know that the iPhone came out in 2007? It's only 12 years old. Only 12 years old. And the whole world's hooked on them. You know, the real issue here is that they have all of this technology today at our fingertips. And when something traumatic happens, guess what? It's instant. It used to be years ago on TV, it took them a few days to get it on the TV. Now it's instant. You got people with their cameras taking pictures while it's happening, and the next thing you know, it's out on YouTube or it's all over the internet, and all of our kids from this big to grown-ups are seeing it. Instant. You ever thought about that? And then on top of that, do cell phones have value? Sure they do. I use them every day in my business. And they're great communication with family and different things. But you know the evil in it? You know how difficult it is for a 6 or 7 year old to just see raw pornography? About 2 clicks, you think they don't learn how to do that? And if they don't, their buddy does? Oh, look here. Folks, technology's good. But on the flip side, technology is the worst thing ever happened to this country. That's where we're at. That's where we're at. That's where young people are. They live on these things. They live on them. Games. The Bible talks about fatherlessness. You know, in 2010, New York State was the last state in the union to approve no-fault divorce. No fault divorce? Really? How does that work? There's no such thing. Let's face it. We've sure painted that one real nice, haven't we? $125, go get divorced, no big deal. Right here in our backyard. Instantly, kids are fatherless, usually. Or motherless, one of the two. One's moving out. Then they fight over the kids, it's even worse. But You know, the bottom line is not that I'm trashing divorce or fatherless here. It's what's going on with our young people that need Christ. And we wonder why they're crashing and burning all around us with no hope and no answers. And we have the answer. Need I say more? We've made it legal now. Raw immorality. It doesn't matter, whatever, fluid, whatever, just... And this is what our kids are turning to. Now, we've been guilty. I was guilty of some of this, the drinking, the two in the middle booze. That was my deal. Yeah, that was my hang-up, okay? But here's my point. On this slide, now I knew as a high schooler that the hippies out in Haight-Ashbury and stuff were doing drugs and marijuana and all this kind of stuff, the hippies. She went in. I just winked at her, so I mean, you know, she. But the point is, I never saw drugs till my sophomore in college when they came into my fraternity. That had been 1968. I never saw them. No, after that I had access and I saw them, and in the Bahamas they were all over the place with the captains and mates and stuff, and I had plenty of opportunity to use and deal if I wanted to. Thank God I didn't. I was smart enough or stupid enough, I guess, to just stick with the alcohol. But the alcohol was my issue. But today it's more meth and the pills, and the heavy hitters are the, you know, the cocaine and the acid and all this other stuff going on today. But all of this destroys lives. I don't care what it is. Any of that destroys lives. They're addictive. They're mind-altering. And they'll destroy you. I said that to these two boys this week. I hope they listen. The Bible talks about having a sober mind. Can't have a sober mind with any of that. Walking in the Spirit. You can't walk in the Spirit and be high on anything. Can't do it. The Spirit wants us to be fresh and right online with Christ. Can't do it and do that. But our kids are all over it. I love this one. You know that? Google's finally admitting they're not the answer. You know all of our kids need to learn that? Every young person in this room today needs to understand the first three or four threads of Google is not truth, period. Most of those people are paying to be those first three or four threads. And they're lying to you about whatever they're selling or whatever their position is. And doesn't mean there's a shred of truth to any of it. Okay? I see some young people smiling. Am I in your wheelhouse? I know what y'all do. You need to be spending time here. This is where your answers are, not in Google. Okay. Go to Google and put your problem in there, and then look for the scripture reference that it sends you to. I do that. I'll go to Google and I'll put in something about, you know, Jesus, Jesus on the cross or whatever, what year, whatever, you know, how long did he stay on the cross. You can put those kind of answers, and it'll give you scriptures to go to. That's okay. You can use Google for that. But those first two or three threads that show up otherwise, when you just want to put in and ask them, well, you know, why am I depressed? Good luck to you. Good luck to you. Okay? Because Google's not your answer. And they finally have admitted it. They've taken down Google Answers. They retired it. Now, they still have Google Feud. So you can go on and fight over it if you want. But they're no longer your answer. They finally admitted that. There's your source of answers right there. Romans chapter 8, verse 1 through 17. Verse 1 says, there's no condemnation to them that are in Christ who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. You know how exciting that is? To know Christ and know that your sins have been forgiven. And even when you screw up, you can confess your sins and get forgiveness. And you're still going to go to heaven. You know what that means to you? What that's saying. Verse 5 says, they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh. That's what these two young boys were doing that I met with this week. One of them, 19 years old, how has had a girlfriend pregnant? I loved it. I'm going to say this to you. Walked in to meet a pastor, and he's got a black t-shirt, black sweatshirt on with a Playboy insignia on the front of it. You know what my first question was? So are you a Playboy? He was doing the backstroke. Pastor jumped on him right out front. He didn't know what to say. I had fun with that. I like to do that to teenagers. To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. You know, the Bible doesn't beat around the bush. You either have life in Christ, or you're dead in your trespasses and sins. You're either living in your carnality, or you're living in the Spirit. Verse 8, they who are in the flesh cannot please God. Wow. Does the world need to hear that? You know how many people think they're being self-righteous and going to please God and hopefully that they're good enough to get to heaven someday? That's where I was before I was saved. On one hand, I knew I was living like hell, but the other hand, I'm such a nice guy that certainly God's going to take me to heaven, right? No, it's not how it works. See? They who are in the flesh cannot please God. If any man has not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And then I like to connect a word, and. Verse 17 says, and if children, then heirs, joint heirs of God. So if we suffer with him, we shall also be glorified together with him. Jesus is the answer. His word is true. We must surrender our lives to Him to be saved and to honor Him and glorify Him and serve Him. There is no other way. Okay? Then we talk about the sufferings of Christ. You know, the confusion, the change, the violence, the divisiveness in this present age, first of all, it's not going to change. It's only going to get progressively worse because that's what history teaches us. The days of kumbaya in America, in my opinion, biblically, are over. I'm sorry. I don't see it in prophecy. So you can do with that whatever you want. I'd love to think there's going to be a massive revival tomorrow and everybody's going to be on their face before God in America. But I don't see that in Scripture. So I tend to think it's not going to happen. But it says the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory which we shall be revealed in us. We are joint heirs with Christ. He's coming back for His church, His bride. We talked about in the men's Bible study yesterday about us being the bride of Christ. We are His prized possession for eternity before God the Father. Because He died for us and we love Him and serve Him and we're His bride. See, that's who we are today. I hope it excites you. We must take His cause. We must take up the cross. We need to maybe partakers of this glory and the eternity of Christ. We may go through sufferings in the meantime. I'm not here to paint a pretty picture necessarily for you. Your life may be a mess. I understand that. God will see you through it. He says, "My grace is sufficient." Sister sharing with me yesterday about how much pain she's been in lately, and she's been praying about it. And so far, God's saying no. And my response to her, "God's grace is sufficient." She just said, "Amen." Right? Folks, that's true. That's the truth of the Word of God. But you know what is exciting about me as I close? I've read the end of the book. I know who wins. And it's us. Father, we thank You for the opportunity this morning to be in Your Word. Father, thank You for the privilege to study Your Word and to expound on it and just develop the need to reach out to young people today as a church. And I thank You for the young people that are here, and I pray for each one of them. And I pray, God, that You'd work in their lives in a special way and love on them and show them that they can have hope in Jesus Christ. Because You're the eternal God that gave Your Son to die on that cross so we can have eternal life. I pray now for the baptism. And Father, I just pray that we'll continue to give You praise and glory in everything You're doing here today in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to go to the back. You're all going to sing and close some songs, and then I'll be back when we do a baptism. So hang around.
Some furniture, too. Got to move. Our closing song goes hand in hand with having a baptism, believe it or not. Shall we gather at the river? Not the tent. We're not gathering at the river. We're gathering. But I'm going to need a couple men to come and move the podium. Let's sing first, and then we'll move the podium. And the chairs apart so that we can see the baptistry. But let's sing.
The saints at the river.
Just move a little furniture here and prepare ourselves for
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. Me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. Ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior. Sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power, made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior. Sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard an